Welcome back to the Unwitting Hour YouTube channel, the home of album reviews, discography guides and think pieces. Now today's review is a review of the debut album from Leeds post-punk band Yard Act called The Overload. And to give you a bit of background as to my own experience with Yard Act, it's kind of strange because they seem to have a similar kind of meteoric rise to notoriety, similar to Billy No Mates, I guess, in a way. Because it was like, one minute they didn't even exist, and then the next minute they were getting co-signs from every other band in like the modern post-punk revival scene. So you've got like Sleaford Mods, like endorsed them, Billy No Mates, obviously, who I think does backing vocals on one song here as well. There was a ton of other people from like Radio 6 and stuff that gave them just this big boost in profile, and I know there's the Brudenell in Leeds is really giving them a push, and so it just kind of seemed like all of a sudden they just kind of came out of nowhere and were this really kind of notable, really kind of credible band in this scene. And obviously, given that like a majority of the coverage on this channel arguably has been about that scene, or a lot of it has at the very least, I thought, you know what, I'm definitely, if people are raving about it, there has to be something to worth digging into here. Like, nobody would be kind of ranting and raving about it so much if there wasn't anything worth discovering. So I sat down, and after a few listens, here is what I thought of Yard Act's The Overload. The opening title track really does give us a good indication as to where this album is going to be heading stylistically. I mean, that's not to say that it spoils all of the surprises the album has up its sleeves, because it definitely doesn't, and I'll get onto that later. But it definitely does give us a good indication as to what this album's like mission statement or sound is, because it starts off with these really cool ominous guitar and bass licks that just sound archetypally post-punk, like the really sour discordant guitars and that really sinister kind of stalking bass line sounds absolutely incredible. But then when the breakbeats and the vocals come in, it almost kind of gives it a punky Stone Roses kind of vibe, like Stone Roses but punky. I'm not saying Stone Roses are punky. Anyway, kind of the way the breakbeat is played, I believe it's played on an actual live drum kit, so that gives it a real kind of organic feel, which I like a lot. And the vocals, while they are kind of comparable to other people in this scene, like Sleaford Mods would be an obvious one, or maybe John Paul, I think that there is a definite difference in the way the vocals are delivered. They have this kind of exuberant yet kind of biting quality to them, which I really like. Like, they're very kind of expressive and very dynamic, but also have that same edge and grit to them that you want from this style. And also, I think that they have a more kind of openly rap delivery than Jason or John do, because it seems like, rather than kind of monologuing, which I do love from those two guys, but I feel like Yard Act take a lot of a more kind of rap hip-hop approach to the delivery, which also does help the song greatly, because it's a very danceable kind of almost funky and catchy tune in a way, very anthemic as well. The chorus on this is absolutely brilliant. Like, the melodies are fantastic, the way it's kind of orchestrated is really great. Again, it's very danceable, very anthemic, but also the lyrics are pretty cool. It's seeming to be about how in the kind of modern age there's all a kind of overload of kind of, you know, news and all these kind of tragedies and stuff and politics that are happening around the world. It's just difficult to keep up with, and I think that lyrical sentiment is delivered very well on this song, so I pretty much have nothing to complain about, because it's a pretty brilliant opener. Track 2 is Dead Horse, and is admittedly a bit of a switch up, because while the opener went for a kind of lively breakbeat sound, while the second track does keep the kind of sour guitars and stalking bass lines of the opener, it switches the breakbeat for a more kind of slower disco funk oriented groove, which I think when complemented with the guitars and the bass is actually a combination that works very, very well within the context of the song. And I think as well, while it is definitely a danceable song, it kind of has a slow, methodical, lumbering feel to it, which I like a lot. So the instrumental on this is great, no denying that. But my main problem is that the vocals and the lyrics don't really seem to meet the quality standard that the instrumental sets on here, because while the instrumental, like I said, is great, the vocals and the lyrics seem a little bit incongruous sometimes. I mean, the lyrics do make some good points about kind of being wary of like fake news in like a modern society, which is a valid point to make, but the delivery of it, for one, is not, it doesn't really fit with the song, because although the track is definitely slower paced, the vocalist seems to be having a kind of one-size-fits-all approach, was kind of using the same fast, ranty delivery that he was on the opening track, but because the track's slower paced, it doesn't really work as well. And I think the lyrics are trying to be a little bit too deep at times. Like, there's a bit, if I remember correctly, where at the end of the chorus, he just, like, does this echo effect. He's like, fake news, I don't like fake news. And don't get me wrong, I'm not saying they can't make the point they're trying to make, because they obviously can, and I'm saying that it's a very valid point. But I am saying that if you are going to do that, maybe do it with a bit more kind of eloquence or subtlety, because if you're doing it with the kind of brash approach that they are here, it can come across a little bit, dare I say, cringe, which obviously isn't the best thing. And the chorus on this song as well isn't nearly as strong as the one on the opener was, which I kind of get, because obviously it's the opening track, you want to have a big explosive catchy chorus to get people hooked in. But this one really does kind of go in one ear and out the other, so you just kind of sat there going, oh, that happened. Like, you know, there's nothing really that special about it. So while I would say that the instrumental is definitely cool on here, with the kind of disco funk groove that it goes for, it definitely feels like the vocals and the lyrics kind of struggle to pull their weight a bit. The next track is Payday, and while it is yet another very clear stylistic shift, unlike the last track, I actually think this is really, really cool on all fronts. So, first of all, the instrumental, the kind of odd electronic drum groove paired with these really grinding, gritty, distorted bass tones and kind of noisy funk guitars is a really kind of weird and disjointed combo, but one that works very, very well in the context of the song. Like, you just have this really strange lolloping groove with these noisy funk guitars going on in the background, and as weird as that might sound, it actually works very, very well. And the vocals on this definitely do work within the context of the song. Like, they kind of use this very heavily accented, very characterful delivery, which I know they have been using on previous tracks, obviously, because they're trying to kind of just be themselves and kind of represent where they're from, but it kind of almost feels like the vocalist is kind of playing around with different odd vocalizations. And because the energy of the track is already very frantic thanks to the instrumental, him being a bit more kind of experimental with some of his vocal parts really lends to the energy of the song here. And I also think the lyrics are very good again, about kind of, it seems, the mistreatment of the kind of working classes or the poorer. By just the opening line, what constitutes a ghetto, kind of gives you an indication of that. And I think the way it's done is very kind of tongue-in-cheek and very wry, but also very kind of on the money, it seems like, or very kind of sure of itself, I guess is the way I would put it. And the chorus is brilliant too. I mean, the vocal line that he sings is really infectious, and the line of take the money and run, the way it's repeated and the riff that goes on in the background courtesy of the guitarist, is really brilliant. And I think in the bridge, the odd sort of bleepy synth lead that they use, while it may sound a bit harsh and a bit kind of odd to the ears to some, I really like it, because I think it has the same sort of workmanlike simplicity and effectiveness of something maybe off of the Slag Heap album, for instance. Like, just the simplicity of it very much is reminiscent of the synth stuff off of that Slag Heap album, which is definitely not a bad thing, because I think it works very, very well in the context of the song. And I also think that the alternate chorus in the outro with the kind of doubled up guitars also is a very, very welcome addition. So all round, while this track may have some very, very odd musical sort of characteristics and sort of bells and whistles, the end result, at least to me, is one that is definitely worth checking out. Track number four is called Rich, and unfortunately is the first track that I would say that I overall kind of don't like, because while I do like the lyrics on this, they seem to kind of come from an interesting angle about how the kind of sudden gain of wealth can corrupt someone's mind and make them greedy or unable to kind of cope with their own kind of life after their kind of acquisition of wealth, kind of reminiscent of a lot of the stories you hear about lottery winners. So from that perspective, it is kind of compelling, but pretty much everything else is a pretty big disappointment on this. For starters, the groove on this seems very stilted. Like, I get that maybe Dead Horse did seem a bit kind of stompy in its groove, but that seemed very kind of deliberate, whereas this is, I think, meant to be a more kind of slow, kind of sort of a lot less danceable and a lot more kind of definite and minimalist and punchy, which I guess it kind of does, but it also doesn't really work too well in the context of the song, because first of all, the bass intro goes on for way too long. Like, I'm pretty sure it's just bass and vocals for almost the first minute of the song, and it really drags on, especially with the slow pace that the track decides to adopt. And also, a side note about this bass line, This one sounds straight ripped from the Steve Hanley, like, This Nation's Saving Grace playbook, which is an influence that you'll see later on in the album, but one that really comes out full force here, to the point where, like, I'm pretty sure this is almost a direct rip of, like, the Mansion bass riff. So yeah, the bass and the drum groove aren't too great, but then the vocals come in and it gets even worse, because, again, like I say, the vocals and bass in the intro goes on for way too long, and in that case is kind of grating and annoying. But also, because the track is so slow-paced, once again, it feels like because the vocals are a lot more fast-paced and a lot more frantic, it doesn't fit the tone or the vibe or the speed of the song at all, and so it just kind of feels, again, very incongruous and a very kind of odd fit. And the chorus is also really odd and not anywhere near as catchy as any of the previous choruses, because it's just seemingly a gang of people just going, "It seems I have become rich," but in like a really annoying and like not endearing way whatsoever, just to the point where it just makes me annoyed and want to turn it off, which is obviously not what you want to do with the chorus of your own song. And the odd introduction of stuff like guitars and synths and bongos and bits of percussion and hand claps throughout the track really don't help its sort of grating quality, because it almost seems like this track is throwing anything at the wall whatsoever, trying to see what sticks, but then it turns out that none of it does, because on top of the instrumental sounding really kind of boring and derivative as it is, these introductions only serve to make it sound more annoying and kind of disorganized. So while the lyrical angle of this song may well be interesting, everything else that goes along with it really like drags it down seriously. Like the vocals are incongruous to the pace and the vibe of the song, the instrumental itself is really boring and bland and derivative, and when it tries to add more stuff, it just makes it even more annoying than it already was. So this is probably the first one I'd actively tell you to try and avoid. Track number 5 is The Incident, and despite a few minor complaints, I actually came out liking quite a lot, because for starters, the instrumental, the combination of a really sort of lopsided lolloping groove with a really nimble bass line and some kind of distorted guitars that almost sound a little bit Nolan Cook-esque, like some of the more kind of modern Resident stuff, the combination of that actually works very, very well and creates a very sort of odd yet danceable yet very kind of lopsided track. But I think the kind of lopsidedness of it works in its favour this time around, and I also think the vocal delivery in the verses, again because of the frantic nature of the instrumental, works very well on here, at least in the verse anyway, because my only major problem with this song really is that the chorus could have really been done with maybe like upping a little bit. Like, it seems like it doesn't last for very long, I think only like 4 bars maybe, and the stuff that is there is very low impact, so it's like the verses are the high impact part of this song, and then the chorus comes in and kind of just dampens it down a little bit and doesn't really do much, which is a shame, because again, the verses I really like. I think the vocal delivery works very, very well. I think the lyrics also are quite compelling as well, and I also like the instrumental, the groove, the bass, the guitar lines on here, everything works quite well. It's just that the only main problem is that the chorus on here is a little bit low impact. But aside from that, this is just a really cool, sort of nimble sounding, idiosyncratic dance rock tune that comes out quite well, all things considered. The next track is called Witness Brackets Can I Get A? And this is just a straight up punk tune, and I am absolutely loving it. Like, for starters, the drums on this were really a standout for me, because the rest of the drums on the album, so far at least, have sounded very kind of mechanical and synthetic and very calculated, which I suppose does very much kind of complement the vibe of the earlier songs. But here, they sound so much more live and organic and punchier, especially the snare and the bass on here. Like, they sound just punchy and so direct and so, like, they, again, just very raw drum sound, which I like a lot, and it definitely complements the style that the song's going for. And I would say that it even sounds organic, even with the addition of a kind of distorted 70s drum machine, which almost kind of gives it a sort of maybe Cabaret Voltaire vibe, if I really wanted to go there. But in terms of the general sound of this track, it's just a very straight ahead, kind of aggressive, yet anthemic and catchy and sing-along punk tune, maybe in the vein of something like a Crass, or if you're thinking maybe like Crass, or maybe some of the early Clash stuff, or maybe some of the Oi scene stuff, or Slaves even. Like, just that really classic, anthemic, sing-along punk vibe, which I really, really love. And again, the addition of a drum machine does give it a sort of weird, eccentric, almost sort of cabaret Voltaire-ish vibe on top of that as well, which I really, really like. And yeah, it is only 80 seconds long, so I can only say a certain amount about it, but even though it is very short, what is here I do like a lot. The next track is Land of the Blind, and to be honest, is a bit of a mixed bag, but I do like some things. For starters, the instrumental on here is pretty good. The groove, again, is very solid, some very nice, slow, deliberate drum beats and a nice lumbering bass line, and the guitars and the group vocals over the top of it, because of how cheesy and sort of eerie they are at the same time, almost kind of remind me of something off maybe the self-titled Gorillaz album or something like that. Like, it's a really interesting kind of stylistic shift for the album to take, but it's a decent one nonetheless. But again, my main problems really come down to the vocals being incongruous to the song that it's trying to be sung on, because it seems like this song is a very kind of creepy, slower paced kind of track that it was going for, and like, the vocals, again, they just kind of do the same thing that they've been doing for this whole album. I mean, maybe they do slow down a little bit, and so the kind of incongruity of it isn't as pronounced here, but it is still kind of noticeable. And again, I guess with the kind of Gorillaz comparison, the kind of influences that the track is based off of are a little bit more evident here too, but it's not too bad, to be honest. And while I do not like, I think that the vocals could maybe fit a bit more with the song, they're not that bad, all things considered. But then, while I might not have too many problems with the bass of the track, there are also a few things that it does that just kind of confuse me. Namely, the kind of spoken word part in the middle of the bridge for no reason at all, when it just goes like, it's like, okay, I'm gonna do a magic trick, close your eyes, and then it just goes silent for like 5 seconds for no reason, and then the track kicks in again. It's like, well, what was the point of that? And like, I do like the kind of quirkier outro on this song, so I guess that's the point in the yes column. But there are just a few things about this track that just seem a little bit off. Like, whether it's the vocals being, again, a little bit incongruous, or the influences maybe being a bit more obvious, or the kind of weird spoken word part. Well, like, there are one or two things that maybe put me off a little bit about this track, but for the most part, it's not too bad, I suppose. Track 8 is called Quarantine the Sticks, and to be honest, I found this one to be a bit of an unlikely highlight, because again, the combination of the instruments here is a really cool and effective one. The nice ominous bass, the really kind of peppy, lively, disco style drum beat is a very nice addition too. The odd twinkly guitars are nice as well, so you know, we're all good on that front. The vocals in the verses as well, I think, are very comical, and the lyrical slant seeming to be about like the government, especially in times of COVID, being kind of unable to allocate their time to like proper things, I suppose. I mean, I don't know how big of an issue this was, because I don't really follow politics too closely, but the lyrics kind of like, why don't you spend your time going catching proper crooks, kind of gives me that impression. And so I think with the comedic kind of presentation that the track has, it plays its subject matter off pretty well, in my opinion. And I also think the chorus has a kind of very sinister, ominous, yet kind of catchy quality to it with the group vocals that it lends. Also, courtesy of Billy Nomates that you can hear in the mix here, and sounding good as ever there. I won't lie though, the transition into the second verse does seem a little bit odd, if only because the vocalist switches the more kind of stream of consciousness approach for kind of sung vocals in the second verse, which, while the melodies he's singing aren't bad by any means, and people may find them a lot more catchy than maybe I do, I just feel like he was kind of fixing something that wasn't really broken to begin with. Like, I thought the kind of stream of consciousness approach of the first verse was very good and kind of comical and very well pulled off. And so to go from that to all of a sudden kind of switching to a more sung delivery, again, while the melodies aren't bad, just seems like a little bit of an odd choice. And I think that the kind of odd synth bleeps in the second verse as well, they don't work too well within the context of the instrumental. However, the more kind of frenetic, kind of bleepy and odd nature of the instrumental outro on this isn't as bad. It's just when complemented with the vocals that things maybe sound a little bit odd to my ears. So yeah, in the end, I'd actually say I came out at the other end of this track liking it quite a bit, because it does have this kind of ominous yet catchy, kind of understated frenetic energy to it that it plays with quite well. And like I say, while it isn't the most grand kind of offering that this album's offered up so far, and I do have maybe one or two small issues with it, I would definitely recommend going and listening to this one, because again, because of how understated it is, it may pass over some people's radars, but I implore you, give this one a listen, because you will end up getting a lot out of it, or at least I certainly did. Track number 9 is Tall Poppies, and is in many ways the centerpiece of this album, and it is an absolute, it comes out of nowhere, because obviously the kind of vibe that the album's gone for so far is a kind of bit more expansive version of the kind of post-punk revival stuff that's been going on recently, and it does that very well. But within that, one thing that I was not expecting was to have a 6.5 minute conceptual storytelling track with multiple genre shifts that just comes out of nowhere, but it does it absolutely incredibly. And let me explain why. So the concept seems to be about a guy who is just like your regular Joe. You know, he plays football five-a-side every day or something with his mates. You know, he goes down the pub, he wants to start a nice family. You know, so there's nothing really too out of the ordinary. But then all of a sudden, when his life seems at his best, you know, he's got a wife, kids, seemingly a stable job as well, out of nowhere, he just experiences a massively brutal heart attack, which leaves him, unfortunately, dead. And so the emotional mood of the track just absolutely does a 180 and all of a sudden becomes really dejected and depressing and very dour and melancholy. And it's done absolutely flawlessly. Like, the amount of emotional and instrumental shifts throughout this track is pretty immense, but all of them are done very tastefully. So it starts off with a kind of jaunty, almost kind of danceable beat with just like some vocals, drums and piano, which works very well. But then when the guitars and the bass get added in, it does kind of take on a more traditional post-punk flavor, which is also very nice. There's a few kind of mildly indie rockish bits that come in at various points that are also very cool. I suppose the sudden introduction of a rap beat about 2 minutes in does seem a little bit off and comes out of nowhere, not really in a good way, but when that synthetic beat is put within the context of the rock instrumentation, it does mesh with the track and fit in with the instrumental a lot better than it did on its own, as it kind of adds another kind of layer of texture to the song, which I think is very effective. But the main, like, cherry on the cake for me with this song is the build-up around 3.5 minutes, because this is when he's experiencing the heart attack, and so you just get this blast of drum beats and guitars, and like the whole thing just dissolves into cacophony while the vocalist is just shouting, "No one's helping him. His grandchildren see him, but nobody realizes what's happening." And the whole thing just builds up and builds up and builds up and becomes more cacophonous and strange and overblown until all of a sudden it just stops. And all you're left with is some guitars, some dejected drums, and some spoken word vocals, which, while very, very minimal and slow-paced, actually work very, very well. Because I've harped on a few times about how the vocalist seems to have a kind of one-size-fits-all approach to his vocal delivery, but here, he really makes sure to dial it back and deliver a very measured, kind of thoughtful and introspective performance. And while, yeah, I do kind of get the argument that the spoken word bit at the end may seem a bit tacked on or maybe a bit forced, just because of how kind of overly emotional or maybe sentimental or like maybe trying to be deep the vocals and the lyrics are here, but I think within the context of the track, that's more than excusable. So this track is just a really brilliant, well-written, well-constructed, methodical, brilliant, conceptual, kind of arty post-punk song that works absolutely brilliantly, and in my opinion, is one of the hallmarks of this whole new revival that's been going on over the past 10 years, because the genre as a revival definitely has its vibe, but this is a standout. Like, just the sheer amount of instrumental, contextual, emotional shifts throughout the song really make this an absolute feat of songwriting that I think is, again, one of the hallmark songs of the revival that's been going on for the past 10 years. And to be honest, I don't think I'll ever hear anything else much like it ever again, or at least for a very long time.
He's grimacing, begging them to notice him, twitching, notice no one is helping him. The grandkids waving through the rear windshield as the big electric game.
The penultimate track is called Pour Another, and it's easily the most fun song on this entire album. I mean, for starters, the kind of stilted, mechanical, disco drum groove that this track goes for does actually work very, very effectively in the context of the song. And the bass, while it does have that very quintessential post-punk flavour, has an almost kind of odd jauntiness to it that really suits the style of the song. And I also think that the vocal delivery, once again, is tailored to the song. Kind of like Tall Poppies, the vocalist has kind of realised that, oh, I can kind of use my vocal approach and kind of meld it to fit the song. And it does it here masterfully. Like, while the verses do have that kind of similar stream of consciousness approach to them, they do seem a bit lighter in tone. And especially when the chorus hits, the singer goes for a much more kind of anthemic, exuberant, kind of almost childlike delivery in a way that works very, very well. And the organ riff on the chorus is absolutely killer. And like I say, this is definitely the most carefree song on this whole album. Like, it just seems so happy and so fulfilled and so kind of, again, exuberant and lively and very kind of, it just sounds really optimistic, which I think works absolutely brilliantly within the context of the track. As do, incidentally, all the weird kind of instrumental additions. Like, I've already talked about the organ riff on the chorus, which is brilliant, but you've also got touches of extra synths and even cowbells that pop in at various points. And while on any other track on this whole album, I would have been like, what the hell are these doing here? Within the context of this track, because it's so jaunty and makes such a conscious effort to take itself not seriously at all, it's like, yeah, why not? Throw everything on there. Cowbells, synths, organs, everything. Just throw everything on there and it all works absolutely brilliantly. Like, again, on any other track, this would be absolutely mad. But on here, because of just how openly ridiculous it knows it is, almost to a degree, it gets away with all of it. So while there may be quite a few things about this track that will seem very odd to a lot of people at first glance, just because of the energy and the vibe that this track puts over, it gets away with absolutely all of it. And like, yes, the track may be ever so slightly cheesy in its presentation, but as you can probably tell, I do not mind one bit. And now we reach the final track, 100% Endurance, which, again, while being another sort of stylistic shift, I think closes off the album very effectively. So to start with the instrumental, while the groove with the drums and the bass is very, very simple and very minimal, the touches of electric piano and synth that get added to the beat throughout the song works very, very effectively to kind of flesh out the instrumental and kind of give it this odd kind of minimal sort of stark beauty to it, almost, in a way that works very, very effectively, especially with that synth that they add over the top of the electric piano, which sounds very airy and kind of I don't really know the word for it. I guess romantic? I'm not really sure. And the guitar solo on this is brilliant too as well, which I've neglected to mention. I mean, there have been a few good guitar solos throughout this album, actually, which I've kind of neglected to mention, which I guess is kind of bad. But this one, I think, is probably the best of all of them. I mean, maybe the instrumental could have done without the addition of the shaker in the second verse, although I do like the touches of tambourine in the outro, which I guess kind of balances that out. I mean, the shaker isn't too bad. It just kind of disrupts the kind of minimal vibe that the track had going. But again, the touches of tambourine in the outro really aren't that bad, so it's probably not that big of a deal. But for me, where this song really shines the most is with the lyrics, because the lyrics seem to be kind of concerned with the universality of kind of human suffering and existential crises, which, while sounding absolutely terrifying on paper, it's done in a way where it turns something that would be absolutely inhumanly terrifying into something really beautiful by saying, like, yes, we all have kind of the same amount of suffering and, you know, the world is going to end at some point and we're all going to die, but we should take kind of solace in the fact that, you know, we are as insignificant as we are and that life will carry on as it is and continue to evolve and change, and we should kind of take the like the small things in life and kind of treasure them because we won't be here for very long. I think it's well executed, and I think it's absolutely one of the most like heart-wrenching lyrical sentiments on any post-punk album I've heard recently, easily. So to put it simply, the combination of a brilliantly unique, spacious and kind of ethereal instrumental with a brilliantly universal and very touching and very emotional subject matter and lyrical sentiment make this track a very, very kind of defining moment for the band, like Tall Poppies in a way, because if anything, these last few tracks have kind of shown the different dimensions of the band. Like, yes, they can do the kind of sinister post-punk stuff, but they can also pull out stuff like this, where you just have to kind of sit back in awe of their ability and just kind of soak up everything that they do, because as like emotional and heart-wrenching as this track is, it's also just brilliantly written and a fantastic way to end the album off.
It's also pointless.
It is. And that's beautiful. I find it humbling, sincerely. When you're gone.
So, what did I think of Yardak's debut album, The Overload? Well, while I have had issues with maybe some of the songwriting coming off a bit one-dimensional in places, or maybe at points there where their influence is a bit too heavily on their sleeves, in other places, this is one of the most unique, well-written, simple, effective, expansive, experimental and multifaceted post-punk albums to come out of the whole movement in the last 10 years, or at least in quite a while, which is really saying something, because, again, while there are a few kinks that might need ironing out here and there, particularly to do with their songwriting, I think that if they were to iron those kinks out, they could do something that is absolutely unheard of in this scene and create something that goes way beyond the genre that it's occupying. Because as we've already seen with this album's success, it reaching number 2 in the UK albums chart, they've really hit upon something very special here, because there are flashes of complete and utter mastery all over this album if you look for it. It's just a case of ironing out those finer details before I really see something that is like a truly and honestly brilliant, fantastic album. But as it is here, it is still pretty brilliant. So if I had to give a score, I'm gonna say strong 7, which I know may sound very low given that the praise I've just given it in the past like 45 seconds, but like I say, there are a few kinks that need ironing out, but as it stands already, it's an absolutely brilliant album. It's just those little touches that could make it an absolutely, utterly incredible album. So I hope that you enjoyed the video. If you did, please do consider liking and subscribing. It would really mean a lot to me. Right, upload schedule. I am saying this definitively now. I uploaded the album review last time. This is obviously the album review that I'm uploading now. But there will be one more album review after this, and then the Not So Friends at Record Society episode 6 will come out, and I will not change that, because I know I said a couple of weeks ago that it would come out within the next 3 weeks, but then a load of stuff came out that I really wanted to review, including this album, and so I had to kind of push it back. But I'm saying definitively now, the next episode of the Not So Friends at Record Society will come out within the next 2 or 3 weeks. It's just that there's this album review that I'm obviously uploading now, the next one, and then that episode, but I absolutely give you my cast iron promise that will be the upload after next. So until then, I'll see you all later.